You may be seated. If you're not in youth group, if you're not old enough to be in youth group, you are old enough to be in Mrs. Price's class. I think, Chelsea, I think you qualify. I think you can still slip in for a few more times. It's up to you, but the kids like it better than me. Philippians chapter 4 this morning. Philippians chapter 4. And we have been in the midst of a study on how to have joy, really, is how we're going to conclude it, but how to handle suffering when things don't go in life the easiest way I suppose they could go. It's funny, I had someone tell me last week that I've lived nothing but a life of ease, and I agreed with them. I said, yeah, it's true. I've had an easy life. But my thought when I agreed with them was that, but if you had my life, you'd think it was hard. Because it's about perspective and how you handle it. And the truth of the matter is that suffering has come, is here, or will come. It's part of life, hardship. And death is a reality for every person who is alive today. Statistically speaking, if you're alive right now, 100 years from now, you'll be dead. And I don't mean to, be a downer for anyone, but statistically speaking, that's the truth. There would be few exceptions to those statistics. Some folks live to be 100, but most do not. And if you've lived more than a couple of years, your likelihood of going far beyond 100 isn't great. Supposing, though, that life expectancy for the generations to come will increase the way it has increased in my lifetime. Now, I've noticed that it seems to me like people are dying younger, but I don't think that that's anything more than an anomaly. Everyone has an appointment, and things cause death before you expect it sometimes, or at a young age. Some people die young, some people die old. But if you die old and you're exceptionally good at it, you excel at it, most likely you won't be alive more than 100 years from now. And if we could, for sake of argument this morning, suppose that death entails suffering. In other words, that in order to die you must suffer to some degree. Then we could assume that at some point in time you'll suffer. Right? If we could assume that death is suffering or that it's hardship. But suffering isn't dying. Suffering isn't entailed in that. But I've watched many people suffer when they died. So that's usually a time of life when people would say, oh, it's suffering, you know. We talk all the time about the person who goes to sleep and doesn't wake up. And everybody says, that's the way I want to go. I want to go to sleep and not wake up. How many of you would like to be in that category when you die? Okay, so we got a majority here. You know, I want to be like, surfing or something, at 100 years old. And then, the ultimate wave, and they could make a movie about my life after that. He was surfing at 100 and slammed into a rock, and what a way to go. Anyway, that'd probably be suicide, wouldn't it? joking about that, sort of. But I don't care how I die, to be honest with you. I figured it out this way years ago. I haven't suffered as much as some people have, but I have been in pain before. I've had excruciating pain before. And I've realized that excruciating pain can go for a long time or it can go away. But it's miserable while it's happening. But I figure if I go through excruciating pain and I die, it will end. And so if that's the way to go, that's the way to go. That's the way the Lord wants it. Anybody can die. Anybody can get it done. Some people scream and cry when they die. Some people are serene and graceful when they die. But I suspect that every one of us, whether we are basket cases and out of our heads, or whether we are in tune and in touch and completely serene, I suspect every one of us will get the job done if the Lord tarries within 100 years. Okay, now, I wanted to start on a little bit of a dour note this morning, talking about death and our death in particular. I want to read a letter for you, actually. Let me see if I can find it here. I want to read a letter from a dear friend of mine. And did you see this on Facebook? I posted it the other day from Earl Jessup. his last letter. Yeah, I want to read a letter from a guy who's dying, actually. I thought about when I was preparing when I read the letter, I thought, you know, this kind of goes with our conclusion in Philippians rather well. Let me find it here real quickly. I should have had it ready to go, but I didn't want to kill my battery. Why does this do this? I'm terrible at using Facebook's app. There we go. Now I can look at my profile and I can find where I posted it. Some of you may remember me referencing a while back a friend of mine, Earl Jessup, who had cancer. And I want to say it's been more than 10 years ago that he got terminal cancer. I got Jeremy Rowland, who is now the executive, or now the director of Baptist Church Planters, reposted a link from Dr. Jessup, Dr. Jessup's last letter. And so Dr. Jessup's still alive today, but here's his last letter. Here's what he says. First of all, thank you for praying so faithfully for us. Second, thanks for your faithfulness to this ministry. And lastly, thank you for all the cards and notes. They've been so encouraging. This morning, we were given news that this new problem is cancer, and it's going to take my life within weeks. Likely, I will not get out of the hospital unless hospice has the ability to handle the amount of oxygen I need. He's coughing. He has terrible fits of coughing. If he just moves a little bit, he starts coughing and can't stop. And so they thought he had an infection, and it turns out it's cancer. He says, oh, please, do not weep for me. The Lord has done so much in the 6 extra years he's given us. Thankfully, in June at the annual meeting, God led us to prepare for this day. We passed a motion for Brother Jeremy Rowland to become the general director, and I would become the executive director beginning July 1st. We planned a big announcement and video for social media for September 1st and trips to regions of the states to meet with pastors to share our plans. Well, here's the big announcement with lots less fanfare. He has actually been doing these responsibilities for several years, and I've been doing executive work during this time. I was just making it official. Now listen carefully, please. Nearly 2/3 of the finances for the ministry come through what most of you call support for the Jessups. This is the money that has kept this ministry planting churches for this many years. You've actually been supporting the general fund, and I just receive a salary. If you can discontinue this investment in the ministry, it will drastically affect the number of churches planted. Please, oh please, don't let that take place. We need this ministry now more than ever. Now here's a guy that has 2 weeks to live, and he's concerned about his ministry living after him. So make sure that the ministry is supported. If you want to do something financial in honor of my entrance to that which is real, a fund for the ministry will be set up. It will be protected in an endowment fund to be used for the ministry with approval by a committee of board members. Later, others may contribute to this fund if you choose to invest your estate in something that will last until the Lord comes. I pray that you will. The Lord allowed my final request. I wanted to minister until the final weeks of my life. Just a few short weeks ago, my wife and I led a young lady to Christ, and just this past week, our daughter led her sister to the Lord. The week before I got sick, I taught my Sunday school class at the church. We have continued to work with young couples, mentoring them as best we can, and the very night I took the fever, Beth and I had made a visit to a lady just given the diagnosis of terminal cancer. He has with exclamation points, he has been so very good to us. Pastor Noel Swinar will be preparing the arrangements for the funeral and will be held in Rogers, Arkansas. He and I are in daily contact, and he will work with Julia to keep you as informed as possible. Thanks for traveling with me over these years. It's been quite the journey. While my departure is near, the journey of helping churches reproduce churches is far from over. Prayerfully, it will continue till Jesus comes. I pray you will be a part of it through this ministry. Please do not pray for healing. Pray for grace for these final days. We are comfortable with how the Lord has led the summer, and we know He knows what He's doing. As Pastor Ed Johnson would say to me, Earl, you're not going to live one day longer or one day less than God wants you to, so go about your business. I've tried to do that. I pray for you. I pray for God to keep you strong in the faith and walking with Him. Thanks again for all you've done. Each of you have been a godsend to us, and without your faithfulness to us, this couldn't have been done. This ministry is as much yours as ours. This is the last letter from me. Brother Roland will take it from here, and I can assure you you are in very capable hands. May the Lord richly bless you, co-laborers in the Great Commission, Earl D. Jessup. And I just thought, man, I want to write that letter. What a way to go. What a guy. And it's sad for me because I wanted to schedule him to come down and preach. And the last time we talked, he said, Brother Price, I want to come preach in your church. And he said, I said, well, when do you think? He said, well, if we schedule a year out, maybe too long. I might be dead, you know. You know, he said, well, I'll tell you what, let's just see if something opens up. Well, nothing opened up. And so that's what I'm sad about. I'm not sad about Brother Jessup going to heaven, because he's not sad about it. And he has God's grace. But let me ask you a question. You think the last 6 years have been a cakewalk for him? It's been just, you know, yeah, I'm supposed to have cancer, but there's no pain, there's no surgery. Now he's had excruciating treatments and all kinds of things he's gone through. I'm telling you, God has blessed the last 6 years of his ministry exponentially more than his entire lifetime. And when I look at him, though, I just think of how different he is from most people I know with the same circumstances. Most people aren't able to say, don't pray for healing, pray for grace. And I'm ready to enter into that which is real. I'm about to head into reality. And what a perspective. I want to look at that in Philippians, because much of that is, much of what motivates Dr. Jessup, or motivated him, we find doctrinally in this letter. And we've looked at it in the last several weeks. One of the things I did for this last week that we're in Philippians this morning is that I took the time to go through Philippians and look at the word joy, gladness, rejoicing, the word kaira, kaireo, kaireo, or whatever it is in the verb form. It's in a noun form, a verb form. And one of the things that's amazing to me is that if you're going to pick a theme for Philippians, you would say perspective in suffering. In other words, how to think about hard times, how to deal with difficult times. But if you were to look at words that are most repeated in Philippians, the word that jumps off of the pages just as you skim the letter, you don't even have to do a word search to see, the word that jumps off of the page is joy or rejoice or rejoicing. So here the Apostle Paul is imprisoned. He has people who are bad-mouthing him. He has people who are befriending him. And as Paul writes this letter, he explains to people who maybe wouldn't understand that this is, things are good, how to think. I want to just propose to you this morning that our happiness is affected by our perspective of this mortal life. Okay, our happiness is affected by our perspective of this mortal life and our expectation towards mortality. Or you could say towards immortality, because mortality means immortality for those that are believers in Jesus Christ. You get this? Okay. You are not unhappy because of your circumstances, and someone else is not happy because of their circumstances, and vice versa. If you're happy, if you're loving life, if you're enjoying it, if you would say to people, I don't want to tell you how I'm doing, because I'm afraid I'd be bragging and make everybody else feel badly. It's not because of your circumstances. It's because of your perspective on life and your circumstances. Now, there are commands in Philippians. The final command in Philippians 4:4 is rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. This is not merely Paul recommending an attitude for the Philippians. This is Paul giving God's heart to believers. Do you know the difference? In other words, Paul isn't saying, well, if you'd like to be happy, here's an alternative. He's saying, rejoice in the Lord always, and again, I say rejoice. In other words, this is a command. This is what you're supposed to do. A believer, if you are not rejoicing, it is not because of circumstances. It is because of a choice. I want to look at some things, and I want us to notice the active aspect of rejoicing, as well as the passive aspect of rejoicing. And so I want to look at this. Paul speaks passively of joy quite a bit in Philippians. It's interesting. In verse 4 of chapter 1, let's look there if you're in Philippians. Paul said, let's read verse 3. I thank God upon every remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine for you all, making request with joy. Now, he says, for your fellowship in the gospel from the first day until now. So Paul said, when I pray for you, I pray with joy, and the cause of the joy is your fellowship in the gospel from the first day, meaning the day they were born again and became brethren and had fellowship until now. So Paul said, when I pray for you, it's a joyous thing. It's a joyful thing to pray for you. And the reason or the cause of the joy is you. Now I will say to you this morning, I think it is important for ourselves as believers to understand that circumstances affect how we feel, don't they? If you get up in the morning and somebody steps on your toes, I think it was it Wednesday night? No, it was maybe a couple Sunday nights ago. Two guys, maybe it was last Sunday morning, two guys, I think it was Eddie and Paco, maybe, I don't know when it was. A couple guys were sitting on the back bench and they had sandals on. Yeah, flip-flops. And as I was walking by in my dress shoes, I saw their toes. And I thought, maybe it was you, Nick. You were one of the guys, weren't you? You and Paco? Yeah, it was Nick and Paco. That's who it was. Eddie always wears flip-flops, too. We got some flip-flopping dudes around here. And anyway, so walking by, I see their toes, and I just thought, man, that would hurt if I stepped on their toes. And I probably wouldn't do that on purpose. But supposing it were to happen accidentally, it would affect the people whose toes were stepped on. Might even cause a chain of events. Who knows? Okay. What happens to you affects you, right? Things that happen to you affect you. I have had plans and had my plans thwarted or destroyed by external circumstances many times in my life. Pastor McClure used to say, just at least once a month when I used to work for him, he said, there's two kinds of people. There's the kind of person that gets up in the morning, they go outside and they see a flat tire on their car and they're like, oh, one person's like, oh, got a flat tire. I can't go to church. And there's a person that comes outside and they got a flat tire and they're like, oh, got a flat tire. I got to fix that so I can go to church. And there's really two kinds of people with regard to that. There's a person that sees a problem and says, well, that's something that has to be dealt with. And there's someone that says, well, there's an excuse to not deal with things. You know, and that's kind of the way it is. Now, depending on where you're going, probably depends on your perspective for the flat tire. If you're going somewhere and you wish you weren't going, like say as a wedding, for instance, if you're going to a wedding and you saw a flat tire, well, that'd be a good opportunity to say, I can't go to the wedding. You know, I got a flat tire. You know, I'll be late and I can't be late. If you are going, you know, to eat barbecue, you know, and you saw a flat tire, you'd be like, well, I either fix this flat tire or I'll jog, you know, something. Something I'll have to give here. You know, I've got to figure this out. And again, the priority, what motivates you is really what affects it. And friend, your perspective is all about motivation. It's about what your motivation in life is. And I just tell you, if you're living for yourself, you don't have anything that motivates you very well. If you're living for pleasure, for self-pleasure in life, your motivation will be based on that, and you're not going to be happy. When things go wrong, you're not going to have a good perspective in it. So here Paul is in prison. And he's in prison, why? What's he in prison for?
Preaching
the gospel. And so he's preaching the gospel. Is he supposed to preach the gospel?
No.
Is it for his own sake or is it for Christ's? Don't get over spiritual on me. Yeah, it's for Christ's sake, right? He's a servant of the Lord Jesus Christ and he's in prison for it. And he's the guy that sang in jail or in prison, right? And he's the guy that is likely, as far as he knows, going to be dead very soon for the cause of Christ, going to be killed. And he's saying to the church at Philippi, when I think about you, I rejoice. And he uses the word rejoice. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 9, I think like 10 times in this short letter. Isn't that fascinating? Now we looked at perspectives in suffering for several weeks, but I want us to understand the passive aspect. Paul said, the reason I rejoice is because of what you've done, because of the good things, because of thinking of your fellowship in Jesus Christ. In other words, Paul said, you're the cause of my rejoicing. Now, Christian, here's an application here. Let people be the cause of your rejoicing, but don't let people be the cause of your lacking joy. Did you hear me this morning? In other words, if you are going to set permissions, Lee got me one of these little things, or he got an extra one of these, I'm thinking about setting it up at home. We've been talking about internet filters, and we were talking about permissions. In other words, you could set this up for Wi-Fi or with your Wi-Fi, and then every person that accesses it, you can give them a level of permissions. So you can let them access YouTube or not access YouTube or whatever. You can set up permissions. And so if you're going to program yourself, and by the way, you do program yourself. You program yourself by what you put in and by what you choose. By what you put in and what you choose to do. So if you're programming yourself, you could set up in your permissions, you could say, access to happiness from people. Check. And then access to frustration or a disappointment or sorrow or, you know, losing control, being an emotional basket case because of people. Access, permission denied. No access. And I'm just telling you, that's a choice. And you have a choice about whether or not people can rob you of your joy or whether or not people can give you your joy. And it's not an either or. It's like, well, if I'm going to let people give me joy, they're going to be able to take it too. No. People can give you joy and not take it. That's the program you want to set it on. That's what Paul was programmed for. Isn't that wonderful? I mean, if Paul could be given joy by people, he could also have it taken away. So the people at Jerusalem who had him arrested and falsely accused him, the people who imprisoned him at Rome, well, they would be able to rob his joy just as much as the people at Philippi would be able to give it. Do you understand this? In other words, if you are going to allow your joy to be taken from you, my friend, that's a choice. But it does not mean that you cannot have joy brought to you, or your joy can't be made full by people as well. Sometimes we think, well, I'm just going to get away from people because people just hurt me. I'm a rather reclusive when I'm not on working time. In other words, my working hours pretty much are 24/7. I got a guy who says he's going to call me at 2 in the morning. He said, I get off work at 2 in the morning. Can I call you? I said, sure, call me at 2 in the morning. I don't know if he will or not, but if he calls me at 2 in the morning, I'll be working. In other words, that's when I deal with people, when they can be dealt with. As a pastor, that's kind of the way it is. So when I don't have to deal with people, one of the things I like to do is not deal with anybody. It's like just turn off access. Just, you know, I put my phone on do not disturb and leave it in another room. And then I go and sit down somewhere with a book and read about things that don't have anything to do with people. You know, or whatever. Okay. Now, Christian, we make a choice of joy, and Paul made a choice of joy. And again, one of the reasons for it was because people could bring him joy, but people couldn't take it from him. Isn't that wonderful? Isn't that a relief? You don't have to shut people off in order to be able to rejoice. Okay. Now, let's look at another instance. Chapter 2 and verse 2. Paul said this. He said, you are able to give me joy. Verse 1, if there be therefore any consolation in Christ, is there? Yes. If any comfort of love, yes, there is. If any fellowship of the Spirit, yes, there is. If any bowels and mercies, verse 2, he said, fulfill ye my joy, that ye be like-minded, be like Jesus Christ, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind. Then he talks about what Christ was like. He was the Son of God, became lower than man, and made himself of no reputation, took upon him the form of a servant. Paul said, if you'll be like Jesus, that'll cause me to have joy. John said something. Yes, go ahead.
What does consolation mean, right?
Consolation means you didn't win, but here's another prize. You know, it's a consolation prize. So Paul's in jail, right? So the word consolation means you're in jail, but, you know, here's a candy bar. You know, in other words, it's maybe you didn't get this, but you got this instead. It's another prize, is the idea. You get it? Does that answer the question? John says something very similar about in 2 and 3 John. If you like to turn there, you can. It's near the end of the Bible, right before Jude and Revelation. Let me look it up here real quickly. 2 John 2 John verse 4. He said, I rejoice greatly that I found of thy children walking in truth, as we have received a commandment of the Father. And then 3 John verse 3. For I rejoice greatly when the brethren came and testified of the truth that is in thee, even as thou walkest in the truth, I have no greater joy than to hear that my children walk in truth. So, Paul is here saying a consolation for my imprisonment, a consolation for my imminent death, a consolation for my physical suffering is that will be that you'll follow Jesus Christ. I can understand it this way. I love being pastor of Fort Lauderdale Baptist Church, and if the Lord permits, I'd like to be until I die. But if I were not pastor of Fort Lauderdale Baptist Church, I would like for Fort Lauderdale Baptist Church to follow the Lord Jesus Christ, to win the loss, and to have a good pastor. You understand what I'm saying? In other words, I'd like to do the job, but if I couldn't do the job, I'd like someone else to do the job better. And that would be a consolation. It would console me. I would say, well, I'd love to pastor those people, but here's a guy that's better at it. Well, good. If I love the ministry, then I love what's best for the ministry. Do you understand the consolation concept there? Okay, so Paul says, so we can take this application of consolation and joy and say this. Your expectation for life may have been disappointed, but the consolation is more eternal and it's better. If it's correct, right? Raise your hands. Let's just be honest about this. How many of you thought as a young person that life would be different? How many thought life would be different? Yeah. How many of you thought, not church this morning, but how many of you thought that at this time in your life you would be somewhere else? Most of us, right? Many of us did. Well, let me ask you a question. Is there any consolation? Oh, yeah. For some of us to be like, thank God. Thank God that what I thought life was going to be didn't happen. Oh, it would have been terrible. Sometimes it's a relationship, and you find out later, you're like, woo, glad that didn't work. You know, sometimes it's a job, and when you realize, you know, what the job is, not the name, you know, the big long letters that you spell when you're a kid and you want to be it. You know, maybe you want to be a neuroscientist or a rocket surgeon or something like that. Maybe those are things that you dreamed of, and then you found out what they were, and you thought, you know, a rocket surgeon's a boring job, you know? Happy you got that, right? All right, maybe more. Anyway, whatever it is you thought you would do, you found out you got to be outside in the cold. That's no fun, you know? I wanted to be, when I was a kid, I had a mixture of things. I always wanted to be a preacher, but I throw out some other things. For a while, for fun, I wanted to be a fighter pilot. I don't have the good enough vision to have been a fighter pilot, but I thought that would be fun. And then the other thing I thought would be fun would be like an alligator catcher. So, you know, kind of like I grew up in Kansas, and I read a book about an alligator catcher. And I thought, oh, that'd be fun, catch alligators, you know. So, as a child, those are, you know, that's the gamut of my desires. Well, let me just tell you something. Had I succeeded in being a fighter pilot, you know where I would have been the last 10 years? Where the people I know that are fighter pilots have been, Afghanistan. I don't know about you. I know that I could have joy in Afghanistan, but I'm just really glad I've been in Fort Lauderdale instead. had I been an alligator catcher, do you know how many fingers I'd have left? All the people that wrestle alligators that I've seen, you ever go to these alligator wrestling shows and note the lack of fingers on these guys that wrestle alligators? My fingers are stiff in the morning, but they're all there, you know, and I appreciate it. I like it that way. In other words, there's a consolation, isn't there? For anything that could be, there's a consolation for that which could not be. And friend, for anyone who is in Jesus Christ, the prize of the consolation is far greater than anything that you would have to set aside with regard to expectation or hope or anything that you would experience by way of disappointment. Anthony, glad you're here. Did you ride with him on this morning? Good job. You said you would. You did it. That's great. You got him up this morning, Amon?
Yes.
Good job. Man, fantastic. I saw him here and then I just realized, he did it. We had this conversation on Wednesday and it happened today. I'm proud of you. Okay, now, so our happiness is affected by our perspective of this mortal life, our expectation toward mortality. We've seen that. We've seen Paul, his use of the word joy. I want to look at it in the passive form. Chapter 4, verse 10. Philippians chapter 4 and verse 10. I like the word here for rejoice because it is not present tense, it is not future tense, and it's not a command, but it's actually in the aorist, which would be past tense. What's interesting, it's not just in the aorist, but it's also passive voice. Now, you know what voice is, right? Active, middle, and passive. Active voice means I'm the person doing the action. Okay, so I slapped Mike's shoe. All right, so that's, I'm active, and Mike is passive. Mike, was your shoe slapped?
Yes, it was.
Yes, it was. So I'm active, I slapped his shoe. He's passive, his shoe was slapped. And then there's middle voice, which is, I slapped my shoe, which means that I committed the action, I received the action at the same time. That's the middle voice. So. Now, I'm the one that caused it, and I'm the one that received the effects of it. Okay, so it's sort of like pulling yourself up by your own bootstraps kind of thing. You know, somebody else didn't pull you up by their bootstraps, or someone else didn't pull up your bootstraps. You pull them up yourself, and you receive the results of it. I know that's being a little silly, but do you understand active and passive? Okay, so here Paul is using the passive voice. In verse 10 of Philippians chapter 4, after he's told them to rejoice in the Lord always, in verse 10 he said, "But I rejoiced in the Lord greatly, that now at the last your care of me hath flourished again, wherein you were careful, but ye lacked opportunity." When Paul talks about their care of him, he's talking about their obligatory provision for him. In other words, he's in prison for the gospel's sake, and they have received the gospel because of Paul, right? So how they get the gospel? Paul. All right? So because they've received the gospel through Paul, because he's a servant of the Lord, it's important that those whom he serves would take care of him. Can you imagine? We don't live in a day and age when we comprehend servants the way that Paul did, but a servant was owned in Paul's day. Now, if you owned a servant, it was his job to serve you, and it was your job to make sure that he survived serving you. And that was to your own benefit. All right, so if a guy has a slave and he doesn't feed his slave and he wants to get work out of him, he can get work out of him until the slave dies. When the slave dies, the slave is no more useful or profitable to the master. So it was a good idea for a master to take good care of his servant. It's a good idea for a master to make sure the servant lives well, eats well, is healthy, is cared for. If a servant doesn't get sleep, is he going to be able to be sharp?
No.
And perform well? No, he needs sleep. So make sure your servant gets rest. If he's got a bad back and he's got a bad bed, is it going to help him serve you if he doesn't have a good bed? No, if you're the master and your servant has a bad back, it'd be a good idea to get him a good bed. If he has dietary needs, it would be a good idea to take care of his dietary needs. You get this? Okay. So if Paul is a servant to the church at Philippi, and he's going to continue to serve them, as he is even here giving them scripture that has a philosophical, now it's not just philosophical, it's spiritual and it's God-given, but it has a philosophical outlook that can change their lives. I mean, literally, if you went around being unhappy and somebody wrote you a letter that helped you to be happy, what's the value in it? Infinitesimal. Because unless you're happy, you don't even want to live. And if you have to live and you don't want to, that's miserable. And so literally it could be life-changing, earth-shaking. So Paul's writing him a letter, and he said, "I'm rejoicing because your care for me has increased." So evidently, they have come up with the ability of helping Paul. If you were in prison, it was possible for you to be fed by those who cared about you as opposed to being fed by those who wanted you to die. There's a big difference in what you'd eat if someone who wanted you to die fed you and someone who loved you fed you, right? So if you were in prison, and Paul, as we read in the letters, he had some special circumstances, particularly when he went to Rome for his first imprisonment. He was actually under house arrest and allowed to have a servant. Allowed to have a brother in Christ actually serve him. It's interesting reading Paul's letter to Philemon and realizing that Epaphroditus had been serving him and helping him. Well, who supplied that? Well, not on purpose, but accidentally Philemon did. So Paul here is saying, I have been caused to rejoice by your care for me. He says, your care for me at the last for me hath flourished again. Now it's interesting because what Paul is saying is, your care for me, I rejoice greatly because your care for me flourished again, which is to say that there was a time when their care for him did not flourish. In other words, there was a time when Paul was in prison, and perhaps Philippi, the church at Philippi, had either promised or had just been obligated to supply for his want. Maybe the church has agreed, hey, this month the church at Corinth is going to take care of making sure Paul's needs are supplied. Maybe this month it'll be the church at Ephesus. Maybe this month it'll be the church at Jerusalem. Maybe this month. Whatever it was, whatever the arrangements were, there was an obligation for the churches to take care of Paul. And evidently the church at Philippi had not fulfilled their obligation in the past. And Paul did not write and say sarcastically, well, I'm happy now and it's about time because I starved for a month. Thanks to you. It's interesting, when Paul talks about rejoicing in the passive tense, he says, you are the cause of my rejoicing, but he says nothing of there being the cause of his sorrow. He says nothing about there being a cause of his grief. He doesn't say, well, you know, I was in a funk of depression for, you know, a month while you guys weren't taking care of me. I thought I was going to die. I thought nobody loved me. And I was upset. He didn't say anything of the sort. Do you see this? Again, it's a, you know, rejoicing, access granted. Complaining, being depressed, being down, access denied. And here Paul is in prison. And I'll just tell you something, Christian. If you think, and if I think, that the cause of Paul's rejoicing was that the church at Philippi was now supplying his need, as opposed to they weren't supplying his need, you're a little mistaken, because he had a lot to be upset about if he wanted to. How many people do you know that have freedom to come and go as they please? Well, most of the people we know, actually, right? How many people do you know that are fed well enough that they need to lose weight? Most of the people we know. How many people do you know that have people that genuinely love them? Well, you probably love them. So you could go down the list of things that people have, but how many people do you know that have all these things that are absolutely upset with life and angry and bitter and disillusioned? And if you talk to them, they're not going to talk about what they have. They're going to talk about what they lack. Paul was in prison. Paul was in prison for no crime that he committed. I've heard people say, well, you know, it'd be one thing if you did something wrong, but you didn't even do anything wrong and this happened to you. Well, Paul could have said that, couldn't he? He's a prisoner. He was a slave for Jesus Christ. And while he's serving Christ, it seemed as though the circumstances weren't good. Seemed like his master wasn't taking good care of him, didn't it? If you want to focus on that. But what Paul focuses on isn't his circumstances. He focuses on what he has that's eternal, and he focuses on what people have done that is the cause of his rejoicing. Do you think Paul might have been a pleasant individual to be around? He'd be easy to host, wouldn't he? I mean, he's a guy that can be happy in jail. He'd be happy at my house. Right? Any one of us could meet Paul satisfied. Listen, if you just took your lunch and cut it in half and shared it with Paul, he wouldn't say, you know, I want the bigger piece. He'd say, I'm glad for any piece I can get. You know, those people, it's just, hey, well, I don't care what I have to do. I'm just glad I get to do it. And literally in a passage of Scripture that's written to help us with perspective in suffering, Paul's perspective all the way through is rejoicing. In other words, he says, I want you to know the things which happen unto me, they've fallen out rather into the furtherance of the gospel. In other words, Paul says it's better. My life is better because of the hardship that I've gone through. Believer, many of us don't have the fortitude, or we don't have the perspective, the biblical perspective, to believe that. I want to look at just a couple more verses and we'll finish up. Chapter 3, verse 1. Paul said, finally, my brethren, rejoice in the Lord. To write the same things to you, to me indeed is not grievous, but for you it is safe. Okay? Paul said, it's not grievous for me to tell you to rejoice in the Lord, and safe for you to rejoice in the Lord. Chapter 2, verse 18, if you'll look back. Let's look at verse 16 when he concludes Christ and His will. He says in verse 16, holding forth the word of life, that I may rejoice in the day of Christ, that I have not run in vain, neither labored in vain. Paul said, I'm rejoicing that my life isn't a waste. Verse 17, yea, and if I be offered upon the sacrifice and service of your faith, I joy and rejoice with you all. Verse 18, for the same cause also do ye joy and rejoice with me. Paul said, a major source of my rejoicing is that my life hasn't been wasted. Friend, I want to conclude with this morning, because I believe this is the greatest reason that individuals who know the Lord Jesus as their Savior are frustrated and unhappy in life. It's because they're running and laboring in vain. In other words, what was Paul doing? You tell me. What was Paul's life all about? Charlie, what was it all about? Preaching the gospel. Was that a worthwhile endeavor? Was it a costly endeavor? Was it a painful endeavor? Was Paul in prison because of it? Okay. And Paul said, I'm rejoicing because my life isn't wasted. Now, here could have been the alternative. Remember when Paul talks about things he could have benefited by if he were in the flesh, things he could profit by? Hebrew, the Hebrews, an Israelite, all of his qualifications in chapter 3, a Pharisee. You know what Paul wouldn't have had if Paul had had the confidence in the flesh? He wouldn't have had rejoicing. Is that amazing? There's a big difference, isn't there, between the Paul you meet in Acts chapter 9, who is breathing out threatening and slaughter against the disciples of the Lord. Does it sound like a happy guy? Does it sound like a fulfilled guy? Does it sound like a satisfied guy? Literally, when he breathed, he talked about murdering the disciples of the Lord. He talked about threatening the disciples of the Lord. And now he's talking about rejoicing. Did Paul lose? Was the consolation in Jesus Christ, was it worth it? It absolutely was. And Christian, I just want to tell you, from the Word of God and the authority of the Scripture and the example of a man that God used, that if you'll serve the Lord Jesus Christ, whatever you suffer as a result of it will be the source of your rejoicing. If you do not serve the Lord Jesus Christ, you will not have joy. And that's Paul's key in Philippians. He's not saying, hey, you can't be happy till you get in prison for your faith, and anything less is failure and doom. He's simply saying, no matter what happens as a result of following Jesus Christ, it's a source of rejoicing. More than 10 times in Philippians, in a short letter, Paul uses the word joy, rejoice, rejoicing. What a wonderful testimony. Father, thank you for what you've taught us this morning. I ask you to help us to learn and live it in a real way. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.